Hey House Audio is pleased to present Nutritional Tools for Diabetes, written and read by Julian Whitaker.
Hi, I'm Julian Whitaker, and I want to welcome you to the Whitaker Wellness Institute. In this lecture, I will discuss how we differ in the treatment of diabetes from conventional physicians. We strive to sensitize your body to insulin. Conventional physicians strive to lower the blood sugar by increasing the amount of insulin by drugs or injection to lower the blood sugar pharmacologically. These two approaches are inherently different. We will discuss how diet can reduce your requirement for insulin, sometimes reduce it down to zero. We'll discuss how exercise will sensitize your body to insulin. And we'll discuss why a diabetic should take vitamins and minerals the rest of his life, the nature of how that disease causes nutritional deficiency. And we'll also discuss some new developments in certain minerals that even act like insulin, and at least in animals, make the disease go away. Okay, let's talk about diabetes today. And you've got to understand that a lot of the things that we do here with diabetes are very, very simple. I think a lot of the degenerative diseases that we have and that we suffer from are simple. We kind of make them complex. We talk about all kinds of metabolic abnormalities. We make them very difficult to understand. And consequently, if it's difficult to understand, then it becomes difficult to understand how the therapy is supposed to work. There are two forms of diabetes. One form is called insulin-dependent diabetes mellitus. That is the international nomenclature, IDDM, insulin-dependent diabetes mellitus. The second form is non-insulin-dependent diabetes mellitus, NIDDM. The first form used to be called juvenile onset. The second form used to be called adult onset. Then the first form used to be called type A, and the adult used to be called type B, but now he's dissatisfied that the nomenclature is insulin-dependent diabetes mellitus and non-insulin-dependent diabetes mellitus. Now, both are conditions. They're not diseases. They're conditions. We all have blood sugar measured in our blood. And even in the normal range, it will range, say, from 75 to 110. We know that if you get much higher, then you have what we call glucose intolerance. The body is unable to keep the blood sugar level down. So an elevation in fasting glucose is generally thought to be diabetes. The body clears the blood of glucose with the use of insulin. Insulin is produced by the pancreas. Glucose is an essential nutrient, and you have to get it inside of your cells. And so insulin is necessary to open the door of the cell to allow the glucose to go in. So insulin is like a key that opens the door of the cell. In type 1, what we call insulin-dependent diabetes mellitus, the pancreas has stopped producing insulin. This is generally because the cells that produce insulin have been damaged. And we are now beginning to classify that form of diabetes in the same classification as rheumatoid arthritis and systemic lupus erythematosus. We are classifying diabetes or insulin-dependent diabetes, the early stages of such, as an autoimmune disease, to where the patient's own immune system is attacking the beta cells. Often some form of disease sets this off, like a virus, a cold, or a flu, and then the immune system begins to take offense and for some reason zeroes in on the cells that produce the insulin. So the key factory has been shut down. And when the key factory has been shut down, the door to the cell doesn't open, and the glucose levels continue to rise. In this form of diabetes, that glucose will continue to rise and will actually cause death. Now, what happens with this glucose rising is that the body actually begins to starve. It's like being on a raft in the ocean with water that you cannot drink. So you die of thirst because the glucose cannot get into the cell. And so the cell now is running without glucose with glucose just outside of the cell that can't get in, and it is producing and burning fat. And as it burns fat, it produces ketone bodies. And these ketone bodies are released into the blood, cause a very acid condition in the blood. And this is ultimately what causes the person to expire unless they have fluid, insulin, and glucose. Or fluid and insulin, primarily. The second form of diabetes is not related to insulin production. In general, those who have the non-insulin-dependent diabetes mellitus have plenty of insulin. But the insulin simply doesn't work. It's as if something has gone in and stuffed up the keyholes of the cell with fat so that the key can't get in. So the glucose is there, the insulin is there, but the insulin doesn't work, and it's called insulin resistance. We're now looking and realizing that insulin resistance is related not only to this form of diabetes, but is related to high blood pressure, it's related to high triglyceride levels, it's related to high cholesterol levels, it's related to heart disease. So insulin resistance, the same form of insulin resistance that causes diabetes, is also related to many high blood pressure states. The four symptoms of diabetes are polyuria, polydipsia. Polyuria means that you're going to the bathroom a lot. Everybody knows that. Polydipsia, you're drinking a lot. That's the Latin for excessive drinking. Polyphagia, you're eating a lot. But since you're not storing your food, you are in a stage of weight loss. So those are your four symptoms. Passing a lot of water, drinking a lot of water, eating a lot, and losing weight. These four symptoms apply only to insulin-dependent diabetes mellitus. The other form of diabetes mellitus, which is the non-insulin variety, has no symptoms. They simply have modestly or moderately or even significantly elevated blood glucose levels because they do not continue to elevate their glucose level, causing the diarrhea. How many of the diabetic population, or what percentage of the diabetic population do you think are the insulin-dependent variety or the non-insulin-dependent variety? What would you guess? The insulin-dependent variety constitutes only 10% of the diabetic population. The non-insulin-dependent variety, which is adult onset, is fully 90% of all those who have diabetes. Now, this is unfortunate because most of the public thinks of diabetes as a disease in which there's not enough insulin, correct? That is true for only 1 out of 10 diabetics. For 9 out of 10 diabetics, they not only have enough insulin, they have excessive amounts of insulin being produced by the pancreas. We do a C-peptide test on all of our diabetics. And the C-peptide is a measure of the amount of insulin that the body has been producing. Gives us an estimate. The normal range is between 1 and 3.5 or 4. We have diabetics who have a C-peptide of 12, meaning that they're producing 3 times the amount of insulin that is being produced by a normal individual. But they have diabetes because their insulin does not work. The individual who has the true insulin-dependent variety will have a C-peptide level of 0.3. So they have very low production of insulin. But the general awareness that diabetes results from inadequate production of insulin is simply wrong. And I think it's perpetuated because the real problem of insulin resistance is not treated best with drugs or insulin. It is best treated with diet, exercise, vitamins and minerals, and weight loss. Lifestyle changes, as we'll see how those lifestyle changes work. Now, if we really told people a lot that the problem was insulin resistance and that insulin resistance could be altered rather dramatically with lifestyle, then you would not have this perception that we're going to find this cure for diabetes. You see, we're going to cure diabetes, or we're going to find the key to diabetes, or this insulin production loss. Consequently, it's also easier to get people on a regimen of drugs if they think they have a deficiency rather than an excess.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.